Last year, I was flying back home from the United States. After arriving to the airport in an electric car, drinking my beverage out of a paper straw, and washing my hands with water of painfully low pressure, I eagerly boarded a 210-ton plane. What I didn't realize is that aircrafts are responsible for close to 2.5% of global carbon dioxide emissions, releasing 1,000 megatons of carbon dioxide a year. In fact, most commercial flights that we fly on are vehicles that produce roughly 90 kilograms of carbon dioxide per passenger per hour. This meant that every other step I took in my life that day to combat climate change didn't change the fact that I had contributed to global warming. In fact, the aviation industry is one of the only industries whose emissions are set to increase as opposed to decrease. So that means that the industry we consider to be the most modern and technologically advanced could unstoppably progress backwards if we don't find solutions soon. Now, in this situation, we are left with one last chance to not have our grandchildren tell us that this is the latest fashion. And in a society where we want to evolve as quickly and as efficiently as possible, we seriously need to rethink the global billion-dollar industry that, let's face it, in terms of emissions, just isn't 21st century. Now, with a growing number of 4.5 billion passengers, which for your context is how old the Earth is in years, and a growing number of 30,000 aircrafts, which for your context is how many times I'll say the word aviation in my presentation, the global aviation industry is one of the largest growing industries on the planet. That being said, ever since aircrafts were commercialized, they've been improved in terms of size, comfort, price, and even luxury. But little action has been taken to reduce the impact it has on the environment. Now, it's not like we haven't tried. Our main problem is international borders. Because a majority of planes fly internationally, climate laws are harder to implement because they require multiple nations to comply. This means that the need to replace fossil fuels is more prominent than ever. Now, replacing fossil fuels, the advantages of that doesn't just stop at gaseous emissions. Airports generate water pollution due to their extensive handling of jet fuels that can contaminate nearby water bodies. Now, when jet fuels poses such a big threat, you may wonder why we don't just go to electric planes. The problem is, electric planes require extremely heavy batteries, and until less dense ones are invented, the ones that we have now have a limited time frame, typically 124 miles as a range on single charge when fully loaded. Now, this drawback could be shrugged off if it were a device or even a land vehicle, but a 5% charge warning when you're 42,000 feet high in the sky isn't exactly the experience that we all want. In 2021, the global aviation industry committed to achieving net zero emissions by 2050. This collective goal is more ambitious than any other previous goal. This is where the hero of today and the hero of aviation comes in: hydrogen. Now, hydrogen is extremely different from the alternatives, from the other alternatives of fossil fuels that we have today. The reason is, alternatives still emit carbon dioxide, achieving net zero emissions, which is the balance between the amount of greenhouse gases that are being emitted and the amount of greenhouse gases that we're removing from the atmosphere. However, hydrogen provides us scope to fly while producing absolutely zero emissions, which is undoubtedly the next step that we need to take, because the world isn't getting any cooler. And despite how good-looking this audience is, we're not getting any younger. This means that our time to take action is running out. Now, I know what you might be thinking. How will hydrogen, that's in water, that's in human bodies, that's found literally in every living form of life, a tasteless, colorless, non-toxic, odorless gas, solve a problem that we've been trying to solve for decades? What you might not know is that hydrogen is one of the lightest elements. In fact, it's 3 to 4 times lighter than any other jet fuel. But that doesn't change the fact that it's the richest molecule known to man, making it on an almost identical energy level. What it also means is that it's highly combustible, and it has the highest energy per mass of any other fuel. Also, it can be turned into liquid or gas, and the best part, it doesn't release any emissions. So basically, it's the TED of fuels. Now, how does this change the aviation game in terms of carbon footprint? Hydrogen can be produced from renewable sources such as wind, solar, and hydroelectric power through a process called electrolysis, where water is split into hydrogen and oxygen using electricity. This means that hydrogen can be generated without relying on fossil fuels, further reducing its negative impact on the environment. It also means that ticket prices for consumers might increase, but that's okay because as time goes on, consumers could benefit price and comfort-wise. This is because developing hydrogen-powered aviation technologies could lead to innovation in aircraft design and propulsion systems, leading to more efficient planes and therefore appropriately matched ticket prices. In terms of safety, hydrogen's properties make it safer to handle and use than fossil fuels used today. For example, hydrogen is non-toxic, unlike traditional fuels that can be toxic or contain toxic substances. Also, hydrogen is much lighter than air, so it dissipates rapidly when it is released, allowing for relatively rapid dispersal of the fuel in case of a leak, reducing the risk of an accident. But replacing fuel in 100% of planes as soon as we need it may not be possible. This is where it is important to consider that with the normal four-class configuration, a plane can hold 544 people. However, if all the seats were economy, it would have a maximum capacity of 853 passengers. Now imagine it's the year 2050. You're on a flight to a Taylor Swift concert, who, by the way, doesn't get trolled on the internet anymore for the impact her private jet has on the environment. The flight you're on is a little different than the ones we have now. It's possibly triangular shaped and more spacious, or carries more passengers per flight, since hydrogen requires planes to be longer, which is also good for reduction in emissions. And the best part is, it didn't cost you as much, and you feel much less guilty about leaving your carbon footprint behind on Earth. Now, taking into consideration the added tax on planes powered by fossil fuels in the future, what hydrogen aviation means on a much larger global scale is that we strengthen global ties and geographical difficulties are no longer prominent. It is easier for people to travel for work, and we are much closer to developing, brace yourselves, flying cars, vehicles that are already in the making using, you guessed it, hydrogen. This could also mean that the 95% of the Earth's population that have never been on a plane in their lives have the opportunity to travel and explore the Earth for work and education. Exports and imports become cheaper, and our planet's difficulty in breathing is lowered with electric vehicles on land and hydrogen planes in the sky. Now let's snap back to reality. In order for this to happen, consumers and airlines both have to compromise on technical aspects for a while. This is because shifting even a fraction of one of the largest industries on the planet from a convention it's been following for over a century, and something that, in this industry, has never been done before, without a doubt raises its own obstacles. One key aspect in which hydrogen-powered aviation will require a highly specific approach is the fact that hydrogen's energy density is very low with respect to its volume when it's in a gaseous form. This is why, for large commercial air transport applications, liquid hydrogen systems may prove the most viable. Keeping this in mind, controlling the temperature of the liquid is essential, because if the temperature exceeds a negative 253 degrees Celsius, a layer of hydrogen gas can form in the tank, causing a non-fatal but pretty problematic situation in the system. The good news is, companies are already working on systems to adopt these changes and change the aviation game, and they are making it work efficiently at a surprisingly fast rate. Now, another possible concern may be the waste of the water hydrogen is extracted from. However, of all the water on Earth, more than 99% of the Earth's water is unusable by humans and most living things. And scientists have developed a system that can produce green hydrogen directly from seawater without the need for any pre-treatment processes. And this is revolutionary. I can read your minds thinking, if all of this is true, why haven't we been using hydrogen-powered planes all along? The truth is, no matter how many minute reasons there may be, we'll never have a definite answer. This question is arguably the equivalent of asking why we started using single-use plastic bags instead of cotton bags years ago. When we invent things, Our main goal is to get them to work. And then, once they prove to serve a purpose and their function solves a problem, most of the time, it's to make it as marketable as possible. At first, 120 years ago, when planes were invented, their main purpose was to help military groups fight in wars and transport crops and other goods. People were relieved they didn't have to travel in steamboats or trains anymore. And just like how in 2023, we can't picture a world without planes, back then, in 1903, most people wouldn't have been able to even fathom the thought of changing fuels for no reason other than the environment, when they had much more, at the time, prominent problems as a human race. So if history teaches us anything, it's to always keep in mind the future. It's easy to get carried away with exciting ideas and inventions, but at the same time, it's important to consider problems and negative impacts that we laugh away as mere jokes now, like AI. But I guess we have that covered when we thank ChatGPT after it does our work for us. All this being said, sending hydrogen to the sky and beyond, literally, has been going on for decades without most people being aware of it. In 1988, the Soviets flew the Tu-155 as the first hydrogen-powered experimental aircraft, and for decades, reputed space institutions like NASA have relied on hydrogen gas as rocket fuel to deliver crew and cargo to space, including the Apollo. So when major companies and nations have mastered the practice of using hydrogen as the backbone of spacecrafts, commercial airline companies that account for 93% of emissions that aircrafts produce don't have a problem coping. Highly experienced firms have now started producing models of the potential flights we may fly in tomorrow, and some are even getting started on those flying cars. According to the World Economic Forum, by 2035, hydrogen fuel cells could be used to electrify mid-range flights, and hydrogen combustion aircraft systems could be used on long-haul flights. Now, the next step for us as consumers is to trust this air revolution. When we're looking for solutions to problems that seem way too big, especially for a student like me, it's important to consider the fact that the answers might just be right around us. They may even be like hydrogen, a part of us. That's right. This entire talk was based on something that's present inside of you. That's in my hands. Now I think that's an idea worth sharing. Thank you.